Good evening. 7 o'clock. Gonna get started. Grab a hymn book and get ready to sing tonight. Sing unto the Lord. He is worthy of all our worship and praise. I just want to say tonight, I'm not one to flatter anybody, and I know Pastor Reg doesn't like to be flattered, but that message this morning was a blessing to my heart. And I was so glad when you just kept on going, and that was needed. And I just was thinking about it this afternoon, and this hymn came to my mind, Blessed Assurance. Look at that first verse tonight. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation. There's that. We're the children of God. The heir of salvation. Purchase of God. Born of His Spirit. Washed in His blood. I'm so thankful tonight that we can know with a surety that we are going to heaven. And we don't have to worry that we're going to lose our salvation somewhere down the road. But He will keep us to the end. Let's sing this out tonight. Number 463. You sing it out to Him from your hearts tonight. Blessed assurance.
Blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation. Purchase of God. Born of His Spirit. Washed in His blood. This is my story. This is my song.
Savior. Let's see tonight. Joe, would you mind opening our service in prayer? All right.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, Lord, I thank you that we can come to your house again, Lord. Help us, Lord, to listen to the preaching, Lord. Help Pastor Reds, Lord. Help him preach the gospel, Lord, and preach what you want to do, Lord. Lord, just bless this message, Lord, and help it to reach those out there, whether online, Lord, on TV ministry, whatever you have out there.
Yes.
Lord, just please help us through our week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And those of you online, I hope you have a hymn book handy and you can join in and sing with us tonight. Next hymn is going to be number 504. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Number 504.
There is a song in my heart today, something I've never had. Jesus has taken my sin away. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Wonderful, marvelous love.
tonight?
I hope so. If you're saved tonight, your cup ought to be overrun. So let's show it tonight as we sing this last stanza. Sing unto him. He's worthy of all our praise. On the third verse.
Oh, won't you come to him with all your care, weary and worn and sad? You too will sing as his love you share. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Oh, say, but I'm glad, I'm glad. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Jesus has come and my cup's overrun. Oh, say, but I'm glad.
Amen. I should have had you stand for the last stanza, but you can stand now. And we'll have a time of greeting one another, and we'll come back and sing another hymn, and then the Campbells have a song for us tonight.
And get them songbooks out. Keep it rolling along here. Brother Dave, what song are we singing? 410 in your hymnal there. 410 in your hymnal. While you're turning there, I was reflecting today about pastoring. And man alive, I tell you, just so many things happened. But I hadn't been preaching too awful long. As a young couple got married in church, and I mean, they just seemed like the happiest couple, you know, and they got married. Brother Field took off on a honeymoon. Well, they got back, and that first Sunday that's back, I could tell it just didn't act like the stuff was, you know, too good. So I'm back at the door shaking hands, you know, and they come by, and the guy leans over and says, Reg, could we talk to you tonight after church? So we got problems. So I guess so. So I go to their house after church. And I says, hey, you know, what's the problem? And boy, I mean, they're just like, you can just tell. I mean, they are at odds. And he says, well, ask her. She says, well, I'll tell you what's wrong. He says, she says, you just have him to tell you what's wrong. I says, well, what's wrong? He says, the problem is she does not make biscuits like my mother. And he says, I don't like it at all. It's causing a big problem here. And I kind of looked at her and says, well, what do you think? And what's your side about? She says, well, I told him that if you made dough like my daddy, I could make biscuits like your mother. That's a big lie. You know it's a big lie. But some of you guys need to remember that. If they've got a problem with your biscuits, it's all because of the dough you're making.
Well, let's try to sing again after that one. Number 410, 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, and that it is. Number 410.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise.
Family's going to come up and have a special for us tonight.
The Lord spoke to Moses, set my people free, for I have heard their groanings and their cryings unto me. But Moses said they would not believe nor hearken unto me. Take the rod that is in your hand and lay it at my feet and cast it on the ground. See what can do. You don't know the things He has planned for you, and for centuries, when people learn of you, they'll see what a little faith in God can do. The Lord is calling you to set this dying world free, but you are scared or unprepared. You're sure they won't believe. The rod you're holding is holding you. Release it from your hand. Let go of all you think you know. Surrender to God's plan and cast it on the ground. See what I can do. You don't know the things, He has planned for you, and for centuries, when people learn of you, they'll see what a little faith in God can do. Noah built an ark, though he had never seen it rain, and Abraham laid Isaac down, though it cost him great pain. What is the trial of your faith? What is in thine hand? Lay it down at the feet of the great I Am, and cast it on the ground. can do. You don't know the thing.
You don't know the thing.
He's planned for you.
He has planned for you.
And for centuries, when people learn of you, they'll see what a little faith in God can do. Learn what a little faith in God can do.
Couldn't help but think while they were singing, Tim. First time I ever met Tim was down at Camp Joy, and he had a cowboy hat on, and I was walking down the hill, and he came in alongside me and started talking to me. And the more I listened to him, first thing I said, well, I got me a real genuine redneck with me. No, he just impressed me just to have good common sense. And just kind of been friend to him ever since. And what I was thinking about Tim was when you and Misty got married up here. And what a blessing that was to see the fruit of that marriage being used that way. And I just want to encourage you guys, that's a blessing. I'm telling you, that's a blessing. And I can see some, boy, I mean, tell you what, that family harmony is good, ain't it?
That's,
well, Michael, there's going to preach for us tonight. Say amen. Go ahead, say amen. Some of you might get out of here. We might get out of here decent time. I don't know. But anyway, I thought you heard enough of me today, and I asked Michael if he'd preach tonight. So he said he's ready to go. So, Michael, thank you, buddy. Appreciate you. Love you in the Lord.
Love you, too.
Well, praise the Lord for that. That was worth coming tonight already. Amen. Boy, it's been a good Sunday. I got a question for you guys tonight. Do you believe this book? I'm talking the authorized King James Bible, that God preserved this Bible for us to have and hold in our hands. Do you believe it tonight?
Amen.
This Bible. Stake my eternity on this Bible. If we didn't have this Bible to guide us, to direct us, to lead us, to comfort us, I don't know what we'd do. I'd be lost. I wouldn't have anything. But we've got the book. We've got the book tonight. And we're going to open it up and feast on it. It's better than any television program you might have on tonight. Is we got the Word of God with us that we can read, that we can. This book, it's a love letter from God Almighty to us. It ain't going nowhere. No man's going to take it from us. God gave it to me. God gave me this book. God gave you this book. You got to love this book. I love this book. I'm telling you something. It's a good book. Turning it to 1 Thessalonians. You know, it's one thing to know it's the Word of God, though. But do we believe the book? 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. Start out there tonight. Start in verse 13, if I can find it. All the T's are together in the New Testament there. All right. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Chapter 4, we'll start in verse 13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. So we have the people sleeping there are the dead Christians. And he says, you don't want you to be ignorant about them, that you don't sorrow about them, as others do that have no hope. We shouldn't be as those that have no hope. We have a hope. Praise the Lord for it. Verse 14. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, not man's opinion, but the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. You're not going to stop it. They're not going to stop this. Verse 16, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Praise the Lord for that. What hope we have in that. Verse 17, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Let's pray. Lord God, I thank you for your words. I thank you, Lord, that we can talk to you, Lord, and you talk to us and guide us and direct us, Lord God. I thank you for your mercy and your grace, Lord God. Without it, I'd be done, Lord God. And tonight, Lord, I pray, Lord, that you just fill this place with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Give me the power, Lord, of the Holy Spirit. Just take me out of the way, Lord God, and preach through me to encourage, Lord, and to comfort and to edify your church, Lord God. Help us tonight, Lord. We're asking you to meet with us. We don't want to waste our time, Lord. We want to meet with you and to worship you, Lord, and to praise you and to learn from you, Lord God. Help us tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. So he's saying right here, look, we've all lost loved ones. Most of us have lost loved ones. And he's saying, look, if they believe in the death, the burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, then don't, we shouldn't be as others in this whole world that when somebody passes away, that's it for them. They think it's game over. And this whole life, this little vapor that passes by like that, it that's it. That's all they've got. And we're saying, we've got hope. We've got hope in Christ. Listen, this world gets bad and rough, and we look around at, I don't want to get too far ahead, but we look at the elections, we look at the filth, the garbage all around this world and this country, and that's not where our hope is. Our hope is in Christ. And listen, you know what he says here? He's gonna come down. He's going to descend with a shout. We're going to hear that shout. Amen. We're going to hear a shout as we get caught up in the air. And all our the dead ones, those that are asleep, they're going to go first. Amen. And we're going to see them in the sky. Listen, if your loved one, if they're a Christian, if they believe, if they're born again, you're going to see them again. That's what our Bible says. You believe that? Our Bible says that our loved ones that have lost, that they're not living anymore, but yet they're born again, they're going to be the first ones up in the air. And then we're going to see them. I'm excited about that. I'm excited about Christ coming back. He's coming back. This world is as rough as it gets, and it's going to get rough. It's going to wax worse and worse. We know that, right? That's not where our hope is. Our hope is in Christ's return. It's, you look at the schools, you look at, you know, the Bible talks about a sin of being effeminate, men being effeminate. It drives me up a wall. And you know, there's something I want to raise my boy. I want to raise them to be men. You know, I don't want them to be all sissies. Like, and it seems like anymore you walk around and you got all these little sissy guys everywhere, and the world's teaching them that, hey, men aren't supposed to be men. And that frustrates me. And if I get my mind off of Christ, then I get depressed. I'm like, what's this next generation going to come to? They need the truth of God's word. And you know something? Hey, church, we're running out of time. Christ is coming back. Look at this. Chapter 5, verse 1 here. But of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. There goes your date setters. But you know something? We're closer. We're closer than we ever been. We're closer now today than we were yesterday to Christ's return. I'm looking forward to it. And it's going to come as a thief in the night. Verse 3. For when they shall say peace and safety, you ever heard that? You hear that from government officials? You hear that from the lost? Oh, peace and safety, right? Then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with a child, and they shall not escape. You know, when a lady's given birth, like it or lump it, that baby's coming when it's due. And there ain't no stopping it. You know, that's on a call. Sometimes you run on a pregnant lady and everybody's like, well, just don't have this baby. You can't stop it. And what he's saying is, when Christ comes and you're stuck, and you're not born again, it's too late. It's too late. And people need to hear the truth. Look at this, verse 4. But ye, brethren, that's to the church here. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that the day should overtake you as a thief. Ye are, listen to this, ye are the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of the night, nor of the darkness. The reason why Christ is telling us that is because that's going to be our temptation, to be part of the darkness. He wouldn't have to tell us that if that wasn't going to be a struggle, would he? Look at verse 6. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. Let us watch and be sober. I'm afraid the church today, all across our country, is falling asleep. They snoozed out. They're not excited about Christ's return. You know, I listened to old sermons and used to hear a lot of preaching about the second coming. A lot of preaching about the second coming. And Christians were excited about Christ coming back. I mean, they were excited about it. I mean, it was like, Christ's going to come back today. Maybe I'll see you, maybe I won't. There was an old saying, I'll meet you here or there or in the air. You ever heard that before? That was a common thing among Christians, from what I understand. I'm not that old, but from what I understand, what people say. But Christians should be excited about Christ's return. And if we're not careful, we get consumed by the world around us and how bad it is, and we get our mind off Christ and on the world, and then you're like, man, you know, I guess I'll just go to church, you know. I'll sing the hymns, and we just go through the motions asleep. Meanwhile, the time is ticking. Tick, and we're getting closer and closer to Christ's return. And we ought to be excited about the return of our Savior. Imagine that, caught up in the air. Oh, I'm excited about. You know, all the wrongs are going to be corrected. You know, nobody is going to get past God Almighty. God Almighty, we got a God in heaven, and there's not a thing that gets past Him. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Not for us. Amen. We got to keep our mind on Christ. Amen. Not fall asleep. Fall asleep. Boy, it's a temptation. Yeah. You know, there's some days, I'll be honest, where I just want to go off to the farm, milk my cows, raise my family, and I don't want to see what this whole crazy world's going to do. You know what that would be? Falling asleep. Yeah. Fall right asleep. Let the world just go to hell. It's going to hell. The country is going. They love darkness. But the moment you fall asleep, you're getting that darkness all over you. See, there's not a neutral ground, really. There's not really I'm just going to be neutral over here all by myself. It's the reality of it. There's alive and awake and serving Christ, and then there's going off into the world. The devil lies to you and tries to tell you, well, there's just a neutral place that you can be, and you can just have your relationship with God and not worry about the world, not worry about serving God. And that's a lie out of the pit of hell. Amen. The moment that, hey, you can't commune with God and have fellowship with God and not have a love in your heart break for this lost and dying world. You know, and you see, like, the effeminate men all over the place, ought to break your heart that they don't know the truth. These young men. Amen. They go to kindergarten, they go to first grade, and from the moment they're getting this perversion pushed in their head. And where's the church to say, hey, men are supposed to be men, women are supposed to be women. There's a Savior. You don't have to live in this slop. Amen. They're looking for answers. They're not getting them from the public school. They're not getting them at home. They're not getting them on the TV. They're not getting it on YouTube. Where's the church? The church is asleep, I'm afraid. We got to wake up. We got to wake up. Look at Luke 17 real quick, and we're just going to lay some groundwork and then get into the message here. And then we'll get to it. So Luke 17. You guys know this, verse 23. We'll start verse verse 22. And he said unto the disciples, the day will come when ye shall desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man, and ye shall not see it. Verse 23, and they shall say to you, see here or see there, go not after them, nor follow them. For as the lightning that lighteth out of the one part under heaven shineth unto the other part under heaven, so shall also the Son of Man be in his day. Christ is going to come back like it's lightning. The whole sky is going to light up. And that's going to be my Savior. This world's getting worse and worse and waxing worse and worse and worse. And one day you're going to hear that trump. You're going to hear that shout. And the light's going to be, and you're going to be, that's my Savior. You'll be caught up in the air with Christ. Amen. Where are you going to be found? How are you going to be found when that day happens? Sleeping? I'm excited about it, though. We ought to be excited about it. We ought to have it on our mind. Christ's return. What if it's tonight? Would that affect how you live today? What if it's tomorrow? What are you doing tomorrow? Christ come back tomorrow. Verse 25 here. But first must he suffer many things and be rejected of this generation. And as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it also be in the days of the Son of Man. You know something? The Bible says it's going to get worse. It says it's going to be like the days of Noah. So part of me is like, well, you know, I'm not looking, I don't want my country to go down the drain. You know, I want our country to repent and turn to God. But I also believe this Bible, and he says right here, in the last days it's going to be as in the days of Noah. So at the same time, it's not a surprise. It's not like we don't know that it's going to get worse and worse and worse. But you know what Noah did? Pastor talked about it. He preached righteousness. He kept preaching. He didn't give in to the darkness of the world. He didn't stop because they made fun of him building a boat. He preached. He preached the gospel. So where are we at? Why aren't we excited about the Lord's return like we used to be as a church? I mean, be honest with yourself. Are you wake up thinking, okay, is the Lord coming back today? And they're excited about it? We ought to be. If you can get in that mindset of Christ is coming back, what do I got to do today? What do I have to do? And why aren't we there? You know, I think of Rebecca, you know, coming when they were sending for Isaac to have a wife, and Rebecca taking that camel. Well, let's turn to it just real quick. Genesis chapter 24. I think of this. It's a good deal. I was pretty excited to learn about this one. And she's riding that camel. You remember that? The servant's taking her back to her spouse there, Isaac. Look at this. And verse 63, Genesis 24, verse 63. And Isaac went out to meditate in the field at evening tide, and he lifted up his eyes and saw, and behold, the camels were coming. Boy, that sermon on a camel of grace. You know, when Rebecca lifted up her eyes, and when she saw Isaac, she lighted off the camel. Boy, we're going to be riding that camel of grace, and we're going to light off that camel, and our eyes are going to be on Christ. That's going to happen. That's going to happen. Where you're going to be riding along, and all that's going to get us by is grace, God's grace. Or we'd be consumed by this world. This world's rough. The world's nasty, filthy, and it ain't lighting up. It's trying to get you every way. And it's God's grace that's bringing us through. And then look at here. She lifted up her eyes. And one day we're going to lift up our eyes. And we're going to be, we're the bride of Christ. We're the bride of Christ, and Christ is going to come back and get us. We're his bride. Oh my, I'm excited about that. Turn real quick, since we're in the Old Testament, to Isaiah 61. This is a comfort to us. The Lord's return ought to be a comfort to us. And it ought, if you're anything like me, it also helps straighten out your priorities. Yeah. Knowing that it's around the corner. Well, it helps me to think about the Lord's return. It helps me care a little less about the things of this world and a little more about what God wants me doing. If I can keep that in my head, that Christ is coming back. Look at this. Isaiah 61, verse 1. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. It's a comfort to us. The day of the Lord. Boy, I'm looking forward to it. We ought to be excited about it. But are we living our lives like Christ is coming back tomorrow? I'm not talking about not paying your bills. I'm not talking about that. What I'm saying is, are you living your life according to how God wants you to live it? Because see, we live in a tendency where we're all about comfort, about what makes us happy, about what makes us comfortable here in this temporal deal. And it's real easy just to, you know, I'll get more serious and more fanatic, and I'll get a little closer with God later. But right now, you know, I got to finish this thing that I'm doing in my life. You know, I'll really sell out once I get married. That's when I'll sell out to God. You know, that's when I'm going to really get with it, is after I get married. You get married and you know what? I'm going to have some fun, and I'll get serious once, you know, I have my children, you know, and then it's time to get serious because I'm raising the next generation. Then you have those kids and you find out they take all your time. Yeah. And you go, you know what? I'll sell out to God and I'll really get serious about serving God when my kids are grown. Yeah. And then because you weren't serving God any of this time and you're going about your life, you realize, well, I wrecked it. God's gracious. God's good. And the day to start serving God with everything you've got is today. Amen. It's tomorrow. Christ can come back at any point. We're right at the brink, fell. We're right here, church. We're right here. We're right on the edge. Yeah, the world's getting bad. Yeah, it's getting rough. But we're right on the edge of seeing our Savior. Don't lose hope right at the last minute. Yep. Don't fall asleep right. Don't get despaired by the world going to garbage. Right. If anything, we ought to be encouraged because that means we're getting a little closer. Amen. You know, we can look around and go, whew, I'd hide. Or we can look and say, you know what? I'm about to go to the wedding. Yeah. We got two different mindsets here. Where are we at tonight? All right, now we got the groundwork laid here. So what causes us to sleep? Turn to Colossians. Why is the church getting so sleepy? Not just on a Sunday night or Wednesday night. But we find ourselves asleep. Turn to Colossians. Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. In verse 1, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Are you risen with Christ? Listen, when Christ comes back, if you're not born again, what are you waiting on? You're gambling. It ain't time to gamble. Hey, the Bible says today is the day of salvation. You need to get that right today. You don't know how much time you've got. But to the church here, to those that are saved, if you be risen with Christ, we're supposed to seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Amen. Look at this. Verse 2. Set your affection on things above, not on the things of the earth. And I think that's our problem right there. I think that's our problem. I think that's why we fall asleep, is our affection is on the things of this earth and not on things above. Look at verse 3 here. For if ye are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God, look at this, when Christ, not if, it's when Christ, who is our life. Is Christ your life? When Christ, who is our life, that's our whole life, is in Christ, shall appear, and he's going to. See how it's a time back in. When he appears, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. So what he's saying is, Christ is coming back. And when he appears, where's your affection on? Hey, when Christ comes back, all these things you thought were important, your job, your stuff, your things. In America here, we live better. The poorest person here is richer than Nebuchadnezzar. Think about it. You got running water. You've got a toilet indoors. Most of us got a car. But yet we want something more. Because the world will leave you empty every time. The world just leave you empty and empty and searching for more and more and more. Kind of like eating a double cheeseburger at McDonald's. You know? It doesn't fill you. I want one. I used to order six of those things. My cholesterol. No, but anyways. Thing is, this world leave you empty. This world will leave you starving. And wanting more and more and more and dangling that carrot. The things of Christ, we set our affection on things above, that ain't going to leave you empty. And you're going to realize how empty you are when you're standing before Christ. And all that matters, all that matters in your entire life, everything you've ever done, everything you did, everything you thought was so important, if I'll just do this a little bit longer, all of that ain't going to matter. And all that's going to matter is what you did for Christ. And you're running out of time. We're running out of time, church. Running out of time. Set your affection on things above, not on things of the earth. This isn't any new revelation. I'm not dropping any, we're not getting in any deep doctrine tonight. This is just a reminder. I need to be reminded of Christ coming back. And I need to examine myself. You need to examine yourself, church, of what is my affection on? Because if you're not careful, you get your affection on everything but Christ. Because the devil's not content with your affection being on things above. The world wants your affection. It's going to pry and steal and want just a little bit more of your affection. You say, what is affection? I looked it up in the Webster's Dictionary just to see the old one. It, first definition was the state of being affected. Well, that's deep. The state of being affected. Okay. Second definition was passion, but more generally. Okay. All right. Third definition was a bent of mind towards a peculiar object. A bent of your mind on that peculiar object. And then the fourth one kind of hit home for me. It said a settled goodwill, love or zealous attachment as the affection of a parent for his child. You know what affection is. You probably didn't need any definition there to know what affection is if you think about it for a second. I've got affection for my kids. I've got affection for my wife. You say something bad about my wife, it's my blood pressure go right up. Because I care about her and I love her and I love my children. You know what affection is. I have a lot of affection for my family, for my children. And I want a reciprocal, I think that is, a relationship where you're back and forth. Where's your affection tonight? Is your affection on things above? Think about your children. Think about your spouse. And the affection that you want her to be happy. Right? Yeah. If somebody's upsetting your wife, You want to go solve that problem. Someone mouths off to my wife, we're going to go settle it. Think about your affection to things above. Yet this world comes in and it says, hey, you don't need God. All you need to do is put all your attention and focus on just making a little bit more money. Because, hey, if you get that pickup truck, if you get that next promotion, if you can just get your house a little bigger, a little nicer, well, then you'll be happy. And it wants your affection. It wants your time. You know, I think about my wife a lot. I think about my children a lot because they have my affection. I care what they think. I care what we're doing right now. And my affection towards God, think about that. And so, this world's trying to get in between. You wouldn't stand for somebody getting in between. I hope you wouldn't stand for somebody trying to get in between your relationship with your husband or wife. But yet you let the world just step right in between. Think about that. And I'm wondering why the church is asleep. Why aren't we excited about Christ's return? Christ didn't have our affection. We got a little more. If we're honest, we might say, yeah, we got a little more we want to do down here. I'm building an empire here. I need a couple more days so I can get this truck. I need a couple more days so I can get this promotion. I need a couple more days so I can... And the list goes on and on and on and on, and it's never ending. And wants more of your affection, and more of your affection, and more of your affection. Here's a test. How long in prayer does it take? Is it 15... 20 minutes, half an hour, before your mind starts wandering off to where your affections are? This is home for me. You're reading your Bible, and you can't pay attention because your mind's on your work, mind's on this, your mind's on that. What am I going to do? I got a fishing trip planned. I've got hunting trip planned. We got all this other stuff that steals our affection, and we don't have any affection for the things above. And now, no wonder the church isn't excited about Christ's return, because we're busy doing our own thing.
Yeah, that's right.
And we're sleeping, and we're running out of time.
Amen.
I'm pleading with the church tonight to wake up, and realize, hey, tomorrow might be it. This might be the last week that you have to serve God. This might be it. And when it's all said and done, whatever great business we get, whatever great house that we build, whatever vehicles that we got all solved and everything, ain't going to mean a thing. And you're going to realize, wow, I wasted it. I mean, thank God we're saved. Thank God we have that hope. But if we set our affection on things above and not on things of this earth, when Christ appears in glory, it'll be so much better.
Amen.
Look, here's a warning that Timothy got. Turn in your Bibles real quick to Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 3. It says, "This also know, that in the last days," this is a warning to Timothy. Now maybe you know he needed this warning, but we don't. I doubt that. I'm reckoning this right here applies real close to us. "This also know, that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves." It's all about me. It's all, look, we got a social internet, whatever, a platform, Facebook, that Zuckerberg might have known more Bible than most Bible believers. He realized that, hey, he creates a whole system here that's all about you. He becomes a billionaire. And then you got this, all these social media apps. It's all about me, 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 me. I'm the most important thing in the world. How can anything ever get in the way? And if you're not careful, church, you'll get that same mindset on you. And it'll all be revolving around you and what makes you happy. And the moment something doesn't float your boat or go your way, you'll blow out of church. You'll blow out of your Bible. Because your affection wasn't on things above is what it comes down to. Because you're a lover of yourself. Look at this. Look at this list here. "Men shall be lovers of themselves," verse 2, "covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God." I'm afraid this is the American church. We love what pleases us more than we love the things of God. Now, we never come out and say it like that. No. We go to church. But when it comes, push comes to shove, where are you going to spend your time? Where are you going to set your affection? Is your affection on God and the things above, or is it on this earth? Is it about pleasing yourself, or about pleasing God? Look at this. Verse 5, they have a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. That's a warning. If you're not, that's not idle talk there. That's not idle words. God knew what the last days were going to look like. He knew what the Facebook didn't creep up on God. You know, he knew this was going to be a thing. Men are just going to love themselves. And I'm telling you, church, if you're not careful, you'll get caught up in this deal. And you'll lose your love for God. And you won't come out, the devil don't come out and say, hey, I want to steal your love for God. He says, hey, a little more about you. Hey, what do you got going on? Nobody cares about you like they ought to. You're the most important thing here. And it gets you all thinking about you, what I'm doing, what my thing is. And you don't have time to ask God, hey, what do you want me to do? Right. Open it up. God, how can I serve you, Lord? Where's your affection tonight? You know, the Bible talks about vile affections of the world. It talks about without natural affection. And you lose your affection for God. You lose your affection for the things above. Your affection is going to go all over the place. And it'll get perverted. It'll be all messed up. The world thinks they're affectionate. They think they have the affection towards the right thing. And the devil, what he wants to do is take what's right and turn it wrong. And turn what's wrong and makes it right and flips everything up on its head. Look around. Look around at our country. Men can't be men. Women can't be women. Right. Children can't be children. Right. Drugs are just fine. Yep. The Bible's wrong. Look around. He flips it all upside down. And I'm telling you, if you don't set your affection on things above, your affections will get as flipped up as the whole world, flipping it upside down. Right. Yeah. And it won't happen overnight. Right. It starts with, where's your affection at towards God? Right. It starts with a self-check right here. Right here at church tonight. Where's your affection? It's what God put on my heart to preach. I got to preach what God tells me to preach. We're running out of time. What's your affection on? We're still in Colossians. Look at verse 5 here. Colossians 3:5. Mortify therefore your members, which are upon the earth. Fornication, uncleanness. Look at this. Inordinate affection, evil conspicuance, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Inordinate affection. Says your affections are out of order. Yep. Right. So I'm asking tonight, you got inordinate affections? Where's your affection on? You know, 1 Chronicles 29:3, King David is addressing the congregation and talking to Solomon. He says, moreover, because I have set my affection to the house of my God, I have mine own proper good of gold and silver, which I have given to the house of my God over and above all that I have prepared for the holy house. He had affection for the church. He had affection for the house of God. We ought to have affection to say, I want to go to church. I love being at church. I love the fellowship. I love the singing. I need that. That's affection that I have for the church. And if you look, churches are losing their affection for the church. Romans 12:10 says, be kindly affectioned one toward another with brotherly love and honor, preferring one another. You know something? We'll have our kids sometimes run all over us. Or they misbehave, they mess up bad, and boy, we can deal with them because they have our affection. But a church member, they rub you the wrong way, and I'm done. You know why? Because you don't have any affection for them. We have to have affection. You know that you're saved, brother or sister, sitting next to you or over on the other side of the church? You know something? That's the church. That's Christ's bride. Amen. And when you can realize that, I want someone talking bad about my bride.
Yeah. Amen.
That's Christ's bride.
Amen.
We ought to have affection one toward another. It's the body of Christ. When Christ comes back, what are you going to be found doing? Trying to earn the next dollar? Chasing after the next thing in the world? Turn real quick, the last stop here, 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. You know, you can be excited about Christ's return right now. You can be excited and ecstatic about it right now. You get your heart, your mind set on God. You get right with God and you put your affection on things of God, and you won't, you the same way you won't be able to almost wait for the next church service, you'll be even that much more waiting for Christ's return because your affection is set on it. You're waiting for it. You're like, God, this is getting dark and I'm preaching, but or trying to stand for you the best I know how, but I'm looking for you to come and I need some help. You're looking for that. Did I hear a shout? Because our affection is set towards Christ. Look at here. You're gonna stand at the judgment seat of Christ if you're saved. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, we'll start at verse 9 here. For we are laborers together with God. Ain't that a blessing? Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me, as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereof. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For another foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, look at this. Every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. I'm not going to try it. Pastor Reg ain't going to try it. God Almighty is going to set your work on fire. And I got to tell you, that empire you're trying to build here on earth, that's so important to you, to get that next, I don't know what it is. I don't know whether it's the video games. I don't know whether it's the truck. I don't know whether it's the farm. I don't know what it is. The world tries to creep in all different types of way to steal your affection. Amen. I don't know what it is, but I know this. If it ain't on things above, it'll burn. Yep. It'll be gone. Yep. It'll be, and you realize how worthless it is and what a lie it was. And you're going to stand before Christ, every man. That means every saved person is going to stand and they're going to watch everything that they did in their life, whether it's going to burn up wood, hay, and stubble. And I'm afraid we got a bunch of Christians that got building up their wood, hay, and their stubble and throwing a little Jesus in on it here and there to make themselves feel great, to relieve their to make themselves feel like a Christian. My question is, where's your affection tonight? Because if you set your affection on things above, that'll all get straightened out. You'll have something that'll pass the fire when God judges it, and you're standing before God, your Savior. You know, the one that sent His only begotten Son, died upon a cross, shed His blood for you, rose from the dead, gave you victory. He got all the power over any stronghold that's in your life. God's given you the power of the Holy Spirit to overcome it. He said, don't deny that power. God's given us the power. It's not like he just said, good luck with living this life. No, he gave us the power. Amen. Praise the Lord. We have the victory. So as this world waxes worse and worse and worse and worse, don't be discouraged. Know that the Lord's coming back. What you need to get worried about is serving God, following God, setting your affection on God. And I'll tell you what. It'll make you happy too. It'll give you a joy in your life. And while everybody else scratching their head about, oh, this country ain't what it used to be, and all, it's not looking good on our country. But guess what? This ain't my home. I've got a hope that the world doesn't have. And you get that affection thing set up right with things above, not on things of this earth, and it'll be a light in this darkness. So where do you spend your affection? Where's your affection? That's all I've got. Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
Tonight that helps. What's our affection set on?
Eight.
I sat there thinking about Karen when me and her was going to get married. I tell you, that girl was so excited. She just couldn't wait for me. And she kept, oh, she was expecting our, she just was so longing, looking forward to our wedding day. What's that look about? No, seriously and honestly, you know, in honesty, a young lady getting married, pretty excited about the bridegroom coming, getting married. While she had six brothers, she cooked and washed clothes for, and I delivered her from her slavery. I liberated her.
And gave her six more to wash for.
Huh?
And then gave her six more to wash for.
And then gave her six more to wash for. No, I'm going to be honest with you. What he's preaching on tonight will change the dynamics of your life.
Yeah.
Amen. I'll tell you where, brother, affection comes from, too. It comes from love.
Amen.
Who you love, you're affectionate for. And if you love the brother, you'll be affectionate for. If you love the Lord, you'll be affectionate for your affections are. And you know, that doesn't mean that you're not making a living. You gotta make a living out here, you know. But in that making a living, in that work, in that business, your affections are set on things above. You're doing it unto Christ, and it's not just about more and more and more me and me and me. That's a good message. Well, let's stand, go home.